What's up, Dirty? Boy, they about to go crazy, Dirty, so. What you call Dirty?
Montgomery, Alabama.
Boy, I like that, Dirty. I know that's right.
So, y'all know y'all don't see it, so goddamn, we get up here, we gotta talk to you for a minute. Y'all ain't gotta go nowhere, y'all ain't got nothing to do. But I wanna tell y'all, man, it's an honor to come to y'all city, man, and y'all show us some love like y'all showing. That means a lot to us, you know what I'm saying? That means so much, man. And we wanna let y'all know, y'all made Dirty. If it wasn't for y'all, it wouldn't be no goddamn Dirty. So give yourself a round of applause. Okay, man. And y'all know I was saying that. Let's do it a little bit. When I say Dirty, you say boys. Dirty. 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 When I say rolling, you say boys. Rolling. 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 Boys. With triple gold.
Coming from the streets of Montgomery, Alabama, to signing a major record deal with Universal and Rap-A-Lot Records, the Dirty Boys would be the first to break through out of the Alabama rap scene. Being one of the best storytelling groups in rap history outside of Outkast, this is the story of the pimp and the gangster, Dirty. Born Daniel Thomas, September 18, 1976, Big Pimp would start rapping in the third grade as a solo artist until he found out that his little cousin Tavares Webster, aka Gangsta, who was born August 20th, 1981, can flow just as well as he could. The two would spend a lot of time at their grandparents' house on the west side of Montgomery, Alabama, coming up with different raps and going through different rap group names like Player for Life. They ended up coming up with Dirty, which later became Dirty Boys. Dirty representing Dirty South and the grimy dark sound that they created. Coming up early in the game, winning the local talent shows will give the Dirty Boys the confidence to take over the rap game. Looking to fund their rap career, they started hustling, selling dope, and robbing prostitutes. In 1998, they recorded their first song in the studio. The first song that they recorded would be a Cadillac anthem entitled Rollin' Vogues.
We rollin' Vogues with triple gold. On Cadillac, smoking, side, getting blowed up, chilling in the back, smoking on that. Got my mind to the ride, but when I ride it tonight, and I'm pretty poor, it's trip to the light, because I'm so pimp tight.
They would go on to release their first independent album entitled Country Versatile. They would go on to do open mic showcases at a club called The Rose, which is the same club Dobie and several others unfortunately lost their life in. Winning the showcases every week and going back home to the street life made it feel like they would never get a record deal. Looking to invest some money, a real estate agent slash promoter by the name of Mike Jackson came to their house to see if they were interested in letting him manage them. Upon arrival, once they let Mike Jackson in the house, he noticed a bunch of guns and drugs laying around. So he told them, if you're gonna take this music serious, you have to stop dealing with the street life. And that's exactly what they didn't do. Offering the guys $300 a week to stop selling drugs just wasn't gonna cut it for the Dirty Boys. So they continued to hustle and they got the extra $300 from Mike Jackson. They began to work on their second album, The Pimp and the Gangster. With the album being completed, Big Pimp decided to go to the movies with his friends. After leaving the theater, walking towards the parking lot, Big Pimp noticed that his car was missing, not knowing that this was actually a blessing in disguise. A couple days later, their cousin slash producer, Dr. Fingers, called Big Pimp to come check out some new beats. Although frustrated about his car being stolen, he went over to take a listen. The beat he played them would be the one that changed their career forever, creating hit song, Hit the Flow.
Drive that versatile. No, y'all ain't seen my clique in the wild. We in the hood coming over, kill a style.
They dropped the album February 27, 2001. The album sold over 400,000 copies. A music exec from Universal called one of the local mom and pop stores called the African Head Shop to see how their artist Monica albums were selling. The owner of the store would tell them that Monica albums are doing good, but it's a group called Dirty Boys and they can't keep a CD on the shelf. Every time they stock new, they're sold out within minutes. The music exec asked for one of the CDs, and before you know it, the Dirty Boys signed a $250,000 deal with Universal Music Group. The Dirty Boys quickly became recognized for their graphic storytelling of sex, drugs, and real life situations. Dirty Boys dropped their third album, which is also the last one they put out on Universal Records, entitled Keep It Pimp and Gangsta, which peaked at number 13 on the R&B and hip hop album chart and number 63 on Billboard 200s. This album would include a song called That's Dirty, produced by Manny Fresh, which was also featured in the big movie Malibu Most Wanted.
It was a lot of big pimping.
Completing their contract with Universal, Houston legend Jay Prince wanted to sign them to his label, Rap-A-Lot Records. In 2003, they released their next album, Love Us or Hate Us, on Rap-A-Lot Records. Dropping a total of three albums on Jay Prince's label, things took a bad turn for the group when their manager Mike Jackson would book shows for the group and take the front-end money and not tell them they had a show until the day of, basically pocketing half of the money, then letting them split the other half. The last straw was when Mike Jackson asked Jay Prince for an $80,000 advance for the group's next album. Jay Prince, being the smart businessman that he is, asked the Dirty Boys did they know anything about this advance. The guys were totally clueless about it. Being the type of man that Jay Prince is, he was ready to have Mike Jackson dealt with for the disrespect. But the Dirty Boys said they could handle it. Catching Mike Jackson at a club weeks later, the group would confront him about the allegations. Mike Jackson got real disrespectful, so the Dirty Boys and their entourage beat him like he stole something, because he actually did. In 2007, the group decided to leave Rap-A-Lot on good terms, wanting to explore the independent route. Though they haven't had an album to be as big as Pimpin' Gangsta, their distinctive sound left an enduring legacy and influenced many other artists from Alabama who follow in their footsteps and helped define the sound of Southern hip hop. Today, their music continues to inspire and entertain the rap culture around the world. Paving the way for Montgomery, Alabama, led to other rappers getting record deals like Dobie, Rubber Band OG, DA, Super Nard, just to name a few. The Dirty Boys will go down in Alabama history as the greatest group to come out of Alabama. This was the story of the pimp and gangster, Dirty.